ball here. Anthony's done the opposite. Anthony's very important when it gets to food. But when it gets to innovation in food, it's not there. So, my big question to the speakers is, you know, how do we put Italy back into, I mean, relevance in this game? And we will be having a bunch of speakers covering a little bit the whole area. We're gonna go from upstream, production, agro, all the way downstream to retail, delivery, and food. The food that you have in your table, okay? So, let's start. Let me first introduce Carlos Furman. Did I say it well? Carlos, I mean, has been the former minister to agriculture in Chile. I don't know how many people know this here, but Chile is a major player when it comes to agriculture. And not just that, it's also one of the most advanced countries, certainly the most advanced in, let's say, Latin, when it gets to supporting startups. And so I think his contribution, his point of view can be extremely interesting. Carlos is also now at FAO, F-A-O, and so I think he probably is bringing a bit of a, I don't know, get me wrong, but you know, he's understanding agriculture and the global challenges. So I think he has something to say here. You want to say here?
Yeah.
There are microphones. Okay, cool. Yeah.
Hello. Thank you very much, Chico. What you're not talking,
you will speak in English despite the word in Spanish, but anyway, I am confident that we can understand each other. My first comment, we have only 5 minutes, is about the context for the future of food and agriculture. And what are the main issues of this context? The first one is that the demand for agricultural goods will continue to increase. And will continue to increase because of the growth, population growth, because of the income increase in lower and medium income countries. For example, in low income countries, the income will increase 3 times from now to 2050. And it means a lot of change in the kind of demands, food demands, basically a transition to a more animal proteins, fruits and vegetables, demand of more healthy food. And the other driver of this phenomenon is the urbanization. For the 2050 and so on, 2/3 part of the world population will live in cities. And it means an increase of the food demand, and at the same time, because cities are growing and growing and growing, less soils and water available for agriculture. So, first message, food demand will continue to increase. And probably the profile this demand will change to a more healthy demand, to a more animal proteins, despite it means a lot of problems in other areas, and to a more healthy food. We think this is a crucial issue for the next time, the demand for more healthy food. The second issue is the consumer's information and organization. We are we are living in a sort of social net environment, and it needs more information. I will not qualify if it is good or not, but there is a lot of information available. And consumers used to be more organized worldwide. Of course, here in Europe, but you can look in China, in Japan, in some countries in South America, even in Africa. People is more organized and more concerned and what they are consuming. So this is another issue that we have to take into consideration. The demand for consumers, by consumers, more organized and more informed. And third, I think this change of the consumption patterns should be reflected in the food systems, both in the primary agricultural production and in the processing. And probably the next time will be the time that the world will consume more and more processed food. But this is the issue from the demand side. What are the main issues from the supply side? And I think, as well, we have two or three that we need to take into consideration. First, climate change. Despite some people still continue to deny that, the evidence are huge. We have more and more extreme climatic events. And it means some kind of droughts, flood, few words, we have well updated our agricultural system to this new situation. And it means technology, it means management, it means possibility of risk management, because agriculture and investment in agriculture and food system will be more and more risky because of this factor of climate change. Secondly, we will have less natural resources available to produce more. We have soil degradation, we have water scarcity, we have deforestation. So this is a very difficult equation. We need to produce more with less. And in the context of climate change, it means technology. And in my opinion, it's a huge opportunity for startups, for people that are developing technology to adapt agriculture to this new situation. What are the new paradigms? My colleague will talk about technology. What are the new paradigms? First, artificial intelligence means the possibility of making a more sort of smart agriculture. Big data, and probably big data will be a huge importance in the future, especially for trade and this kind of change between different actors in the climate change and genetic edition. It means new seeds, new ways to produce, new ways to face plagues, animal and plant life. Another issue to take into consideration is the new regulation for processing food. Probably here for some people that are into the food production in the other part of the value chain. Many countries are going to new regulations because the concern about obesity is more and more important and more of that. Even take the last data of the world, it means that there is 850
Because still a big part of the world is left behind. Sub-Saharan Africa is still in hunger, is still suffering. So then we fast forward to nowadays. Nowadays, we are in the area of the fourth industrial revolution. We see all kinds of technologies coming into place and really transforming our food and agriculture sector. We have internet things, remote sensing, geospatial, machine learning, artificial intelligence. They are transforming the way we produce our food, but also the way we consume our foods. We consume our foods through mobile apps, we order our grocery shop online, and we receive it delivered at home. So are we really harnessing the power of the fourth industrial revolution? Not really. There are still, as my colleague Carlos said, 850 million people left behind. 850 million people that are hungry today. Of these 850 million people, 500 million are actually people in rural areas, are smallholder farmers that are not able to produce surplus to sustain themselves. So we have this big paradox here where we have the developed world with developing new technologies, new digital innovation, and even exceeding the way we consume our food. We said 2 million people are actually overweight. And then on the other end, there is a part of the world that could actually really benefit from these new technologies and is completely left behind. On top of these 880 million people, we have other 2 billion people that have, to some extent, some micronutrient deficiencies. So the first paradox is this one. The second one is that nowadays, more people have access to mobile phones than the number of people that have access to clean water and sanitation. So, we have the 20% of the most poor people in the world, and still, out of that 20%, 7 out of 10 owns a mobile phone. In the least developing countries, it is estimated that every year, in the past 5 years, the new number of subscribers to mobile operation grew of 50%. 50% every year, and these numbers are only expected to grow. So how to transform this paradox in an opportunity for really harness the fourth industrial revolution and to transfer the technology that is developed and innovated in the developed world to the developing world? In the past year, I've been working to develop mobile applications to provide smallholder farmers access to weather forecasts, improved climate forecasts, and something that is called agro-meteo advisory services. So services that are localized, that are customized, that combine meteo information, weather information, climate forecasts, with agrological information. This project has been piloted in Senegal and Rwanda, where we worked upstream with meteo agencies and helped them through geospatial technologies, advanced softwares, to produce better weather forecasts. And these data are localized, these more accurate data can be localized and delivered directly on these smartphones, on mobile phones, also on feature phones, through SMS and voice recorded messages. example, knowing that the wedding season will start in May instead of June this year, it is essential information for farmers for taking better management, farm management decisions, and to help them actually really getting that agricultural surplus thing. So there are enormous opportunities related to digital technologies nowadays. My colleagues are working to deliver the same kind of information in the form of market prices. So farmers will know when to go to the market to sell their products, when it's more profitable, and which is actually the provider that can offer a better price. They can get access to nutrition information. They can use mobile phones to detect plant pests and diseases. As my colleague was saying, with climate change, we see an enormous amount of pests and diseases that are transboundary and widespread. We can use artificial intelligence to help farmers recognize those diseases through machine learning. We can educate them on which disease is that, which kind of pesticides they can use, to which seller they should go and buy their products, the most sustainable and the ones that are sold at the fairest price. And we can also capture that information to create a world database where we store all kinds of information on plant pests and diseases. We can use geospatial technologies to track the movement of locals in the desert and the forecast investigations and act early. We can combine this information with geospatial information weather forecasts. We can get big data out of this, and we can use those big data to provide more sustainable social protection insurance schemes for farmers. We can use blockchain to ensure trustworthiness of those insurance schemes. We can use blockchain to track land use and corridors, and all sorts of technology of the fourth industrial revolution. So there is huge, immense opportunities driven by digital innovations. What we need to do is really to transform, to give those digital innovations in the hands of farmers, in the hands of people who need. And the real question is also, how can we accelerate
this process? Yeah, thank you. I mean, especially for starting to point out to what are the opportunities and what are the possible solutions. There are challenges, there are problems, but there's also a lot of stuff out there that can be put in place. And I must also thank you for being the only female participant in this panel. We tried to bring in some others, but unfortunately they weren't available. Such a pitiful follow-up to the previous panel. Talking about solutions, of course there are technological solutions, but as I think our following speaker can testify, probably the biggest problem is not technology, biggest problem in the upstream is typically adoption. I mean, farmers are the most reluctant customers to change their habits. And I mean, they've been stagnant. You know, corn adoption in the Midwest, in the US Midwest, I mean, basically all the theory of adoption has been built on those cases, right? So, Davide Parisi, very happy to have Davide here. Davide is he's the CEO of Pedia, one of the alumni of a program. And what he does is exactly increase productivity in the Africa, in the farming, okay, with some specific solutions. So, Davide, maybe, you know, explain us a little bit what you do, but also, you know, give us a little bit your impressions, you know, in terms of, you know, what's happening globally, but also, you know, what we can do here to improve a little bit the adoption by the system.
Hi everyone, I'm Davide from Iria. Iria is a company and work at Agitech Markets. We are farmers, drones, business guys, and IT guys. But what we do for farmers? We suggest to put decision in the fields, when to do and what to do. Our system is open, observe, prevent, improve. And we suggest the monitoring limits for farmers to monitor the humidity, temperature, soil moisture. And we suggest a good moment for irrigation. You don't pass the pesticides, you use the pesticide, and the good moment of the nutrition. Because we work about three levels of crop: nutrition, treatment, and irrigation. Our analysis is monitoring the limits, we're monitoring the three big, very important data like transpiration of plant with deficit of compressor of air, dew point, and harvest prediction. All data we analyze with our software and our predictive models. It's very simple. For example, this model for downwind, and we suggest the real risk in the fields of this disease. We develop a new technology. For example, we use IoT and artificial intelligence. Our model is dynamic models. It's possible to work everywhere and every time because we use the, I think, our best sensor, farmers. Because when we have the biological evolution of disease in the fields and our models that send the fields out, the farmers in our application send the fields. Okay, we don't have the disease and the new models don't send me the alert. Thanks to artificial intelligence, our models adapt to the different humid conditions. And it's possible how to calibrate these models. Our customers now reduce the 19% of chemical treatments. Our customers produce zero chemical residues and improve organic biological products. We reduce the 18% of efficient irrigation because the irrigation and the water needs are other big problem because usually farmers don't have knowledge with the climate condition about the moment for irrigation. And sometimes farmers missing irrigation and develop a new disease. For this reason, it's very important to put mornings and sun in the morning and after and to want to put water. And other problem is fertilization. Always suggest the good moments that you want to nutrients because our product help the farmers to nutrition and help the cleaning for greenhouse cleaning emission gas, for example, because usually the fields produce more gas NOx, a different for the smart city or car, for example, because the nitrous and the cycle of the nitrous is very important for the cleaning. And we have the vertical solution because for us each plant has the different needs. For example, we start with the lettuce, baby leaf. A baby leaf is salads that you buy in the supermarket in the package in the first range and fourth range. And now we develop a new solution for tomato and strawberry. It's very easy to install, but the device in the field turn on username and password for our application. And our system. We have many customers here. We had the last couple years with 15 new selling units, and we monitor more than 1,000 hectares. Thanks for your attention.
Okay. It's a family business. All right. Which is where I'd like to end the conversation anyway. Okay, so now going a little bit more downstream. So I met Max Lugo and his partner, Alessio, Italian. He's the French guy here in Italy, and Alessio is the Italian in the UK. They have created Forward Foodie, which is a collaboration platform that basically enables, facilitates the interaction between startups and corporates. Stay here, you can also use it. Stay here. Yeah. And so Max Lebon is, yes, an example of someone who's established himself here in Rome. And because I failed with that, I would like to have from you at least a little bit of impressions on, you know, what are the challenges here, and what else can be done. Okay, you know, please first explain us what you do, right? But I'd love to have also pick your brains. Okay? Let's try to keep everything in 5 minutes. I mean, a little bit lengthy, apart from that, very fast. Because I would like to also open up the conversation. Okay, Max.
So you did. Hi everyone. So my name is Max. I was a speaker said about 3 days. So historically, four TVs in the UK, London, myself is in Rome, and I just live here. What we do in a nutshell, we define ourselves as a collaborative platform for the green industry. So what you take it to me is that on one hand, we work with startups, both in food and food tech. We have a group on a number of things, including defining alternative sales channels for their business, for one to actually have a product. We have them to sell online, we have them to actually find all the routes to market. For example, we work with Google to help startups getting their products listed into the Google campaigns in the UK and the main island, just one example. And then mostly what we do with 80% of what we do is doing online innovation and selling for corporate clients in the food industry. So, for example, we work with Danone, Nestlé, Barilla, Nestlé, Amadori, and a few others. And what we do is help these companies to understand what startups are doing, how they are innovating, and how can they work with it. If we consider that bridging the gap between corporates and startups is actually the best way to bring meaningful innovation to scale. And already, but it's really the handbook and the database of startups that we built over the years was included in the products. And I agree with that. Actually, we have about 1,000 companies today. Here we have a few of our tech partners, clients, and other organizations that we work with to come to talk about. But today, I'm going to talk about food tech. I'm going to be very, very quick on this because it's been already mentioned by my colleagues here that, as we probably understood, the food system is not doing so well. Actually, the food conference is called the Future of Food, but at this stage right now, the Future of Food is not so bright. I got one stat here that's quite shocking in my mind, actually, is that one third of food is being produced globally is actually being wasted. It's not, it's 70% of this, it's actually wasted before. It is a really important for the restaurant or the retailers, which is quite dramatic, but at the same time, actually, we have like 9 million people to feed. We need to feed. So, we didn't mention that word that much so far, but is everyone familiar with the term food tech? Has anyone ever heard of food tech before? No? Good. So, about the natural and we could define it as anything that is in the section of food and technology. Maybe to solve some of the issues that we mentioned before. But it doesn't really answer the question. So now I'm just going to give you some concrete examples of what food tech is about. Because we've talked a lot about agriculture, ag tech, decision agriculture, but here we're going to use some examples of it, a bit different. For example, here, this company called It's Bites, they're based in Israel. They develop like a smart device. That actually analyzes the way people should have it from this table to understand what you're eating, what you're eating, and to measure there's also quite a possible to talk about technology, talking about blockchain, and obviously the application of blockchain for the industry makes quite a lot of sense, because you know, companies to be doing experiments and who individuals as a series of products from farm for their consumers. Also mentioned waste earlier, what are the companies that we have to do with the
our house has to be completely rebuilt. We know business is a little bit difficult when it comes down to sustainability. I love this Finnish kid against the big bull from Wall Street. But is business of sustainability a real business? Yes, it is. Millennials think that, well, three out of four things it is. And actually, Generation Z thinks that 9 out of 10 they think sustainability before buying anything. So we have a community that is really thinking ahead of what should be done. So people are there. In fact, in social conscious consumers, we have 113 million 2 years ago, and we're looking at 660 million in a few years down the line, so 6 years down from today. How big is the potential of this industry? Pretty big. Actually, it's 23 trillion, according to the World Bank. Not a small number there. But for when it comes down to agriculture, we have a different number, so it's 7.8 trillion. Really good there. And it employs 40% of the population. In fact, we have 12 million farms around, and it's growing up. The money invested, this is a report from AgriFunder, is around 20 to 25 billion. This is all reported, it's 2015, so it's very improved, hopefully. But, and this is a but, there's some good and bad news in all of this. And here is a but. The good, bad, and the ugly, a very old movies, Cowboys movie from the 70s, again. 24% of greenhouse gases are done, are created by the agricultural sector. Obviously, you have a good picture in the background of cows that take a big chunk of that. The sort of better outlook is biodiversity is not very much there yet. In fact, we're only consuming 5 animal species and 12 crops. Although we could look at a much larger number. In fact, we know that about 30,000 plants could be edible, and this is where agriculture and tech can come into play. In fact, we can elaborate and figure out how many more we can eat and use in our daily life. So, the good news, obviously, is the rise of the conscious consumer, and hopefully, agri-tech. Here we have a couple of entrepreneurs, as well as Roberta and Mia, explaining, and in fact, they have done so far. So, how can agri-tech and food tech be the solution? Well, agricultural productivity, we have increased number of population, we have increased number, sadly, of people die of hunger, going hungry every year. We are now this year, the first year, actually last year was the first year that the number went back up again, and that's not a good news. So agriculture and technology have to create methodology to get there. Genetic, tech, robots, we have drones. I see a wonderful robot in Paris that instead of drones will go through the crops and analyze the soil and deliver real data, which will be much more effective actually than drone. So there is real interest in terms of productivity. Climate mitigation efforts. Climate change is a big problem. You know, we have tea, we all love tea. I lived in England for 13 years. I literally love tea, but tea is suffering tremendously because of climate change. And so for the Brits, I'm sorry, you're gonna have to consume less of it. So climate adaptation and food security. We cannot let people keep dying of hunger. FAO does a great job here. We need to support more of that, more growth programs. They've done a great biodiversity index. It's very important now. Education not just for the farmers, but the consumers themselves. And this is where we need to change something. In fact, we need to talk about the big elephant in the room. I have to ask one question to the public, if Peter allows me, maybe I have a few more. The first question I want to ask is, how many, just raise your hand, how many eat meat a day? everybody? No? Not too many? All right. Good. So how many of you would eat this burger? The Impossible Burger. It's going to be available, I believe, in the US on a large scale. How many, again, raise your hands? Everybody? Right. How many here will eat GMOs today? Raise your hands. Good. Well, these are jumping up. The reason why we should think about GMOs is, well, does anybody know what this is? Raise your hand again. No? Well, this is your corn. For the last 10,000 years, well, the first one was found in Mexico, and they've been developing it so much that 10,000 years later, this is what it looks like. It's massive. In fact, this is about 50 times bigger than the one that you saw before. So this is GMO. Everything we eat is GMO. It's a completely live result that it is. Bio, well, most of the ground that we know is nowadays completely covered in pesticides. In fact, 97% of Swiss agriculture farmland is covered with fertilizer. So whoever does it, oh, it's bio, or it's GMO, and, you know, please. So how do we move forward? We need to effectively reset the way we talk about food. Make sure that the public at large understands that GMOs is here to stay, is the way we're gonna feed the world. There's no other way. We need to make products, agricultural products, climate resilient. We need to have a faster production. We need to essentially reset the conversation today. Thank you.
Thank you, especially for the presentation here. My name, someone saying something more deep like that. I think GMOs are going to change our habit of GMOs very, very fast. I can assure you that. Yeah, nothing changes things more than a nice food crisis. And I'm pretty sure there are a few looming around. Anyone heard about the African swine flu in China? No, they don't know about that? Keep an eye. If you want to see what that means, check the futures for hog meat on the Asian stock exchange in the last few weeks. It went up 50% in about 1 week. In China, it's up 100%. And I think we will have to reconsider a lot of stuff. So, that said, talking about food, although not food production, because we should always remember that then there is a way of bringing it to you, and probably the largest efficiencies are actually in how we're moving food. I'm really happy to have here on stage this morning, who's the CEO of a very well-known startup, probably the most successful startup we have here in food space. Wait, is there anything else? No, I don't think so. Okay.
This is better. This is better. This is better?
Yeah.
Okay. Is it bigger? Okay. So we care a lot about the technology, sustainability. Let's get back to capitalism. We are building the most customer-oriented niche of customers using technology. The first step was to build Brian. Brian is our logistic algorithm. Thanks to Brian, we are able to be the first one in the market delivering food with no limited distance within the city. So basically, you can order from your favorite restaurant, not only the one in your neighborhood. We partner normally with high quality restaurants, with modern brands, so they have customers not only in the neighborhood, but they have customers in the whole city. So they are able to reach these customers. So we built the logistic technology, and we use also a transportation technology that help us delivering food in longer distances. Actually, this logistic platform is also more efficient than the one who use clusters, so who deliver food only 2 kilometers. It's more efficient because we are able to eliminate all the empty travel to get back to the restaurant area. In fact, what we do, we build a route to the delivery guy. So thanks to that, we are also able to be the first one in the market paying them per hour and not paying them per order. So actually, we are the first one for which the delivery guys are ready to work with. Our business model, we make 25% plus VAT from the restaurant, and we take delivery costs from the customer. Obviously, the delivery costs increase with the use of business. For the customer who looks for efficiency, for the customer who looks for experience, as Claudio, who was to surprise his wife, tweeted about Wenda Black. Wenda Black is our luxury service, so we part normally with luxury brands with high quality of food. And we give a service with a special Uber. Uber is the name for our delivery guy. And we also organize events for this customer around the city, because this kind of customer, yes, they want to order great food at home, but they even more want to go out. So we like to meet them in special dinner that we organize for them around the city. For the customer who are looking for efficiency, like Marco was ordering food in his office, we build off lunch. Off lunch is the fastest way to order food in your office. How it works? Every morning you receive an SMS with a menu of the day, then you can click and check the menus on our website. You can decide to answer directly to the message or to go to the website and order. What we do, basically, we create a group, so we are able to make a bulk order that from a kitchen or to the same destination, same office at the same time. What means that? Means that first of all, there is no delivery fee for orders. Secondly, there is an efficiency that comes from the fact that we put together a lot of similar menus from the same kitchen to the same office. This means that for the kitchen, they can then purchase from a global scale. So this means that the price are really, really low. Right now we are starting with 5 euro. So with 5 euro, no delivery cost, you can have your lunch in the office every day. And we offer 10 menus every day, they are balanced, so sometimes you can have fish, sometimes you can have meat. So one day you want to exceed with a burger, the day after you prefer a salad to balance. So you choose if you want to stay on diet or not, but we go for the other way, we try. What we do is to build these groups within office. And so we choose only medium-sized, high-sized office in some areas. Why? In areas that are really dense of small offices, we treat the area like it's a big office. So basically, for example, here in Rome, in this area, or in Farioli, in which there are big concentration of small offices, we treat the street as a big office, and you are able to subscribe. Otherwise, if you live far from this area, you need to be at least 20 people to join off lunch. This is the way we decided to compete, basically choosing to not compete at all with our competitors. We choose some different spaces of competition. While all the others fall in the same area, we are the only one that is giving the chance to order from your favorite restaurant. Thanks to the distance limit, we are the one that has the biggest restaurant choice, because since we deliver food with no limit, you can find, for example, here in Rome, in any point you look for food, you find 600 restaurants.
while if you log in on the Deliveroo, for example, that we developed a year ago, in a, you are able to find 70 to 150 restaurants, and these people serve the suburban area of the city. So we are the only one with the biggest restaurant choice, plus we are the only one with a luxury service, and the only one with a product studied for the lunch office. This is our development. We acquired three companies after owning in Rome. So we launched Naples, Cagliari, and Cosenza acquiring companies, plus Viterbo that we own by ourselves. Very recent new, we merged with Plastofood. This was the biggest player on the very south of Italy, and right now we are the biggest player of the center south. And this is our solution now. We are in 12 cities from Rome to Catania. And basically, we choose this area because it's the one with a lack of big competitors. So, first of all, we're taking this area, and now we're looking north, especially we build this vertical service with which we can differentiate a lot even against bigger competitors. What we saw in the meantime in our culture is that we are starting to see cooking as a form of art. So every day I'm on television and I see cooking shows, I see things like MasterChef, for example, and then at home I see people cooking like if they are in MasterChef, posting things on Instagram. And what looks like to me is that now, right now cooking is not made for cooking every day. People are intending cooking for as a form of art, as a passion, as something to cook for someone, also for themselves, sometimes just to post a thing on Instagram. So basically, we focus a lot on what I call the Sunday meal. So when you have time to make the grocery, you have time to cook for, I don't know, a piece of meat for 3 hours in a slow cooker. So you have time to make a really gourmet dish. But what I see in the meantime is that for the everyday meal is something to be a commodity. So the cheapest and the fastest, the better it is. And it's also new. You see this advertisement from the 60s, which you see that people start selling ready-made meal from 50, 70 years now. So, but we have a lot of problems here. Why? We have a problem of healthiness because food like that is not healthy. If we don't have the problem of healthy, we have the problem of cost. Because if you want to have a ready meal or a delivered meal, you pay a lot. You can't afford to have it every day. So it must be healthy, you are having cheap, and you are having on demand. So how to solve this? Actually, we already solved it. I go back to the back slide. This slide, the one of off lunch, building groups, having bulk orders from one kitchen to one area. The one we are building now is starting from offices. We want to bring this technology to the houses, to big buildings in which people can order dinner in the night. This is the same technology of lunch, starting from €3 per menu, having a balanced offers of menus, so from healthy to more fancy. And also we can differentiate from area, like we are differentiating now, from rich offices to medium one, giving a different kind of prices, and also different kind of quality. We do the same with buildings. So it's what we are going on. In Uvetta now, we are betting against your kitchen and we like to win. Thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you, Simone. And I think we completed the circle, right? We started with the farms and ended up with somewhat circular food at the table. Which of course reminds us that it's almost lunchtime. But before we leave, I would really like to sort of make some kind of conversation here, even with the audience, if the audience is there. There is someone around there with a microphone, by the way. But let me go back to the point. Okay, so I think there was a provocation on, you know, GMOs, right? And I think it all connects pretty well. How can we make this city, which is the capital of a country which has a lot to say when it gets to food, right? How can we make it a little bit more relevant in all of this conversation
regarding the transformation of food and the transformation of agriculture. And GMO is relevant, right? Because I think one of the problems, in a sense, is a very strong tendency in this country, and maybe even more in this city, to look at innovation in a very distrustful way. GMO is, you know, horrid, and then people are just gulping tons of, you know, pesticides in their food without even realizing, right? And not just that, right? I mean, let's talk about maybe also the environment of delivery. You know, how easy is that to get around? So, I would like to, you know, get a comment from everyone here. Maybe starting with exactly FAO, because after all, I mean, FAO is basic road. Come on. I mean, you are the most relevant organization, UN organization. I mean, there's also, yeah, by the way, the World Food Program. Who is the World Food Program based? In Rome. And yet, my feeling is that these institutions, probably because of their very sort of broad intergovernmental nature, are not interacting very much with the system. I can tell you that, you know, as an accelerator, we tried to speak with, you know, FAO, got no response. We managed to develop a good relationship with the World Food Program, but not with their offices here in Rome, but in Munich. So, yeah, I'd love to hear something from you. But okay, let me challenge you a little bit. If
special attention to this development.
I mean, what we've done to food, you know, as Michele will show, what we've done to food as humans, as a human species, is uncomparable to what people are doing in labs now, right? I mean, and of course, there has been more time with that. Evolution played its course on our guts, and now we're used to eat a lot of stuff that 100,000 years ago we weren't able to eat. But still, I mean, I don't know. I still believe that here, more than, and I even don't know how much is it, it is really a matter of consumer demand. Whether instead of influence of specific groups, okay, on the conversation. Daniela.
So GMOs.
GMOs, but also, let me get out a little bit. How do we get the FAO to engage a little bit more with the city on this topic of food innovation?
Okay, let me answer the first question first.
Yeah.
So GMOs equals great potential to increase resistance to crop, also to climate change, fantastic, but again, this country is only the developed world. If we really want to feed this hungry planet, we really need to start developing solutions, technologies, and putting in the hands of those 850 hungry people, 500 hungry farmers. That's the first answer. Second provocation you had for me. Well, we never talk. So let's talk.
Yes. We're not the only ones here. I mean, there are a lot of people. Did you ever speak to Buen? I mean, they're a leader in the food tech system here. Or to Evia. They are a leader in their. Yeah, and they're moving to, I don't want to say anything, but you know, these guys are active in it.
We need to put your solutions to benefit the underdeveloped world. That would be important. But to get to that, and to get to the first question, what we need to get is a systematic change. And I agree that the international development sector, humanitarian sector, start working with private sector. With those innovation hubs, accelerators, incubators, and start building these bridges. The main challenge I face this year is to ensure sustainability for my innovation. Private sector can ensure sustainability for those technologies. So the real challenge is how to make private sector work towards the achievement of the SDGs and for the international development and humanitarian sector, how to better work with the private sector and with the entire innovation ecosystem to really bring those technologies to serve the
well, I can say here, actually I get it, but you know, so we as an accelerator, last year we received like 750 applications. We received last year 750, right? From 86 countries. A lot from Africa, but also from advanced countries, startups trying to develop services for emerging countries. Right? A lot of that stuff, especially in the farming industry, implementation of smart banking systems, farmers, and so on. So we really get a lot of that stuff. But of course, if you're going to get investors involved, especially with that kind of companies, you want to see that there is a support coming in also from the larger ecosystem who can have an interest in this. And so, in the end, we didn't invest in any of these. Even if some were really interesting, we had companies from Israel, they're interesting, even companies were operating in Eastern Africa and so on. But, okay. Is there anyone who would like to say something? Yes! We got one.
Hello, I'm Camila Fracario, and I would like to thank you all for the great input that I received today as part of the audience. I have a question for Mr. Carlos Furche. I know that Chile is very much involved also for the communication to consumers and for nutrition communication and labeling. And recently there was this law that you had labels on packages of food indicating the dangers of high salt, high fat. And it has great impact to educate the consumer and at the same time to work with the private sector to have better products for health reasons and sustainability as well. So I would like to know, from your point of view, how do you see that evolved in Chile, if you have seen some elements that evolved since the launch? Did you see some good impacts for behavior, for health, for other things? And if you consider that something that could be also applicable to other countries, maybe even in Italy, for instance, because we are here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Very briefly, it's true that in 2016 was put in force this new labeling law that implies that all the processes should be announced with a system of black box. When you have to exceed the limit of what you consult. The problem is too short to have an accurate evaluation, but the first information is that it has a big impact in consumers, because people is looking for food that is not this kind of black boxes. And at the same time, the food industry has changed. For example, there is one most important dairy product that has all of this production outside of this kind of black boxes. They adapted to a new situation. And just final comment. So I understand other guys that following different ways to advertise consumers and to regulate the industry production. Why? Because obesity has become a public issue. It's not only a private issue for us. It's a private health issue. It's a lot of money that the health system spends on this kind of products. Last one. I have lived in Italy for the last 11 months. And here in Italy it's extremely difficult to find food without sugar. Or with a clear advertising, what are you doing? This is an example. But probably in other countries of the European Union is similar. And also in countries like the United States. So quite difficult to have a good advertising system. And when I talk in the eventual changes in the next time, I really think that this will be a very important change for the food industry.
Let's also hear the other guys here from the panel. So, Jimos and Rome. I want to hear about Rome. I mean, this is Rome's talk week. So let's spend a few words from the city. Who wants to spend a few words?
So I'm going to stay for you. I'm going to preach for it. And I think startups, the food and food tech startups are being able to play, to solve some of these challenges. So I've been spending 7 years in London and just to Rome back about a year ago. And I can really notice differences in the ecosystem. So investors, VCs, business angels, entrepreneurial culture is something that obviously is not as strong near Rome. Aversion to take risk is something that is also missing. But in particular, if you look at in the food tech scene, you get two ecosystems that are particularly let's say interesting. One is the Silicon Valley, the other one is Israel. And it's a usual situation of very, very impactful food technologies coming out of this space. And I think the reason, one reason is the whole ecosystem and investment landscape. But one of the other reasons, I think, is also about creating communities. And people are very open to share, to collaborate, push over there, which I think is quite similar in Italy. And more not a Chinese food, the food industry, that great things can happen. So it's all about those dominant communities who first create these communities to get ideas to come out of it. So organizing events, get people together, merge people with different backgrounds, and then help the startup grow. So then comes the other side, how do you help startup growing? More acceleration programs, and then getting the organization to pop. So getting all the local program and all the corporate, within the industry as well.
So if you were to say one thing, math.
Yeah, no, of course.
Got a few things, right? And then, we even got a few messages. What would you say, you know, what would you like to see here in Rome happening, say, in the next year? To make, you know, slight first move in the direction of building a more second building.
I would put yes more on the collaboration with bigger organizations. Even bigger organizations need to get more involved into the startup scene, we need to support them. Very early on, not just when they reach to like a latest development, but very early on.
Okay, so in Rome there are not a lot of these players, apart from these guys. There are these guys, there's some Unilever, there's some Peroni, that's it. There's not like a big player. So
Impactor is a platform focused on sustainability. We started with a magazine in 2014, and I literally probably sent about 20,000 emails to every single NGO, general organization, everyone, and I'm relentless. And it takes time. Big organizations like FAO takes time. Work for programs takes time. Start with the smallest way you can engage with them. And you know, you jump from 2014 to 2019, where the magazine that we have has published content from every head of the UN, every head of the most famous and well-known institutes and NGOs that you have around. We have 600 plus organizations that today contribute on a daily, weekly, monthly, and yearly basis to Impact itself. How I've done this? I have a couple of rules that I can give you that come from banking. The rule of the 7 P's, proper planning and preparation prevents physical performance. So you really have to be ready. That's how you tackle a big organization like FAO. The second one is resilience. They love this word. We have to apply it to our business. Courage, and because there is a lot of courage, you're going to have to email them. You're gonna have to say, no, I got so many no's from FAO that I'm interested in that. Totally cool with this. But when they do help me out, it's amazing. We launched a platform dedicated to matching investors and sustainable companies in February, really quietly. But United Nations, UNDP has been helping out a lot. FAO is helping out a lot, CJR, biodiversity. And we're slowly putting together an amazing group of startups that are innovating across all the SDGs, so not just food. And SDG 17, which is partnership, will get there and will get done. But be prepared, be accustomed to how they communicate and communicate the same way as they do. And you'll get there. That's my advice personally, and my 5 years experience with my startup.
That's what about, you know, again, also for you, you know, the next year, if you have to think, you know, you're also based here in Rome, you know, what is one thing you'd like to see happen here?
Inclusive participation in the investments world from FAO, but also you guys, there has to be more inclusiveness. SDGs compared to like generic startup, it's a lot harder. It's a lot harder. I'm doing blockchain plus this, AI plus this, robots plus this, very easy. But SDGs, you have to convince venture capitalists that this is going to make money. I go to actually much more highbrow events, and I wear a red shirt, a red tie, blue shirt, and I talk money all day long, because sustainability is money. 23 trillion, it's not a joke. So more inclusive from all the investment world, more inclusive from the FAO. We need to all stand behind SDG 17 right now, not tomorrow. I heard at the Oasis Global, which is sort of a World Economic Forum, in education, 20 years down the line, 30 years down the line, complete lies. This is not possible. We have to invest today, and we have to invest in seed round, series A, and series B. In Europe, a company that goes through series B is getting $1 for every $14 in the American market, so Silicon Valley. Imagine if you apply this to sustainability. It's not going to happen. FAO has to wake up tomorrow and go like, guys, we're sponsoring you. Guys, we're going to give you an office. Guys, we're going to push you and get this done. You guys are doing a fantastic job, but we have to start talking tomorrow morning at 7:30 for breakfast.
Yeah, I'm not sure this is great important, but you know, again, being a little more specific, I like to hear, you know, things. You know, inclusiveness, yes, it's part of the conversation. But what about, you know, what are real actions that could take place that could make a difference? Yeah. Simone.
I think that there are different. For sure, it's our responsibility to invest in these technologies, and I really desire there to start.
They're small. Rather small. You're not that they are. They're They are.
Yeah. Actually, I think that there are different players who should prepare in different way about building an ecosystem around sustainability. Because for sure, yes, entrepreneurs like me, we see the opportunity, and our role probably is to also share this vision with investors, I mean, convincing investors that there is an opportunity behind these technologies. First thing. Second thing, for sure, government have a big role, because basically sometimes they build the opportunities of opportunity. Because, for example, if they ban plastic, immediately to build plastic-free packaging is an opportunity, and before it wasn't. So, after that, investors start investing in these things. So basically, I think it's not just one player that should care about it, but all together, so it's a real ecosystem that we have to work on. So yeah, I agree that we should start from organizations who are able to build the culture, and the culture will, not will, must come, as to push over governments, over, and then, entrepreneurs will see the opportunity, and then for last, investors will invest. That's what I think. My own experience in investing.
We all understand, guys, yes, that we have to build an ecosystem. Where do we start from? Right? I mean, building investors, of course, part of it, people playing the part, so major actors. You know, what are the actions that you know, can put in place to really kickstart? This is an action. It's an event, it's a small event.
I think we should talk about space, I mean, physical space in which investors can meet new technologies, so I talk about researchers, and entrepreneurs can meet them, because a lot of time researchers are not able to meet entrepreneurs, and mix them together. So in a place like, for example, I think that the role of the university here is not used like it should be. This is different in the States, for example. Probably this is also the reason why investments are 4 times the size.
Okay. Dario, you want to close this up? What we've been talking about. Now, I'm more interested in problem, less interested in GMOs. But you know, it's a very interesting topic. But, you know, how do we make sure that next year this room is filled up with people? Speak with the microphone. Maybe you want to say, so what are you doing as a company?
Okay, my company?
Yes.
Yes, I meet the farmers today. I see.
We have the
farmers and the company and the global food to change the mood of production.
Are you staying here in India or you? What are your plans for the future? Are you staying here in India or are you planning to move somewhere else?
No, we started in Italy. companies. And we sell yesterday the product from Bangladesh, for example, because we open from January open cities. And we have some difficulties because we are from inside the grand large distribution that press partners to produce more foods, and for example, tomato in the winter. And that for us is very strange because it's not general. And the people ask the crop of plants to supermarkets when it's not available for humans and patients. Other question, the resistance of pesticide, the resistance of chemical products. I think the farmers use the chemical products because the nature is not ready for this move of production. Because we ask the food, for example, our experience, we work in many leaf markets, many leaf in the south and western markets. Do you think in the summers we have 15 days, each 15 days we have to harvest? And usually in nature is impossible. But for example, I think the GMO is a different way of solution, but it's not a solution. I think the solution in this moment that we produce low food and we education the people that we are the root of the nature of production. And for us it's impossible to find a sustainable example, we find tomato in Christmas time in supermarkets. It's impossible, isn't it? And we don't must pass this stroke. And we train farmers and the people for a new vision of sustainability of food. We have the disadvantage.
Okay, thank you, guys. I think that we're getting a bit, so I'll try to down here for half an hour late, but we start. Thank you very much for coming. Yeah.